May the roads be open, may our heads be cool, and may the space be cool. As we explore and continue our discussion. Thank you, Dan, you never told me that. How do I start? No, let me start with my grandma. Because I need to place into context Black history. My grandmother was a spiritist. In other words, she spoke to spirit, and spirit passed through her. And she had various spirits, La Madama, La Gitana, El Congo, La Conga, right? Coming from Puerto Rico, Loiza, Black area, that we had, Danny and I had the honor to put together a conference in Loiza, and Bunseke went, and Robert Ferris Thompson went to a Black area of Puerto Rico that my parents grew up in. And we had an altar every day. We spoke to spirit every day. My grandmother healed us every day. Not because of oppression, but because she believed in the traditions of her parents, of her grandparents, and those who came before her and honored them. So that she was very Afrocentric before there was Afrocentricity by Molefe Asante. And it goes to Willie's point that these traditions are embedded in our DNA. We don't learn them from books. Scholars objectify them and put them on pedestals and try to analyze them and critique them. But in our tradition, they live. They're in the oñero that is prepared, in la hierba that are prepared with alcohol to heal you, in the laying of hands that is now called Reiki, right? It is taking you to the ocean so that you can get cleansed. It's going to the botanica to buy hierba buena, rompe zaragüe, abre camino, and all of those hierbas that we know work. Because our people wouldn't maintain tradition just because of memory. They maintain tradition because they work. And we have to understand that, especially African descendants, have to put your experience at the center of your conversation and your thinking and your philosophy and your sacredness. Compared to nothing, compared to itself. And we have to understand that. Because we talk about liberation, liberation is putting yourself at the center. The aesthetic that we speak about is different. It is, and it should be. Why not? Growing up, my grandmother would cleanse us. When I had an exam and didn't study too hard, she would cleanse us. When there was sickness, she would cleanse us. And when there was celebration, Othello, and Selena would be on the record player singing to Jumbo. I would help cleanse her altar because that was part of my responsibility and also getting away from cleaning the rest of the house. So that, I grew up with altars. I grew up with multi-layers of color. I grew up with the understanding that red is not red, that blue is not blue, that white is not white, that yellow is not yellow. They have meaning. That form and space have meaning. That relationships are at the center of meaning. That nature is at the center and essence of who we are. So that when I started my journey to become an artist and an art teacher, it was very interesting to me that everything I did was considered loud, was considered confusing by my professors. I went to NYU. And when I was asked to do a still life and I painted the altar of my grandmother, the professor would tell me, well, that's too busy. You have color against color, texture against color. That's not the way it is, right? And one day I started painting it grays and beiges, and my mother looked at it, and she was like, why are you painting in grays and beiges? Those are the color of dead people. Those are dark spirits. Why are you painting in those colors? I said, because that's what the teacher wants. She said, well, the teacher is not paying your school. I'm paying your school. So you know what I tell you. Those colors don't belong in the house. And if you can imagine, my house was... the color of the ocean was on the walls. The mismo pink was on the color of other walls, right? And the green of the palm was in the color of other walls. You understood the gray and black as dismal colors did not belong, or beige, because what color is beige, right? So when I get to El Museo del Barrio and I develop an exhibition on African traditions in Puerto Rico, in Loíza specifically, because of course I was looking at my family. All the Puerto Ricans in my body were saying, oh no, that's not Puerto Rico, that's Haiti. No, that's Africa. That does not exist in Puerto Rico. And I was like, that was very interesting. That we did this exhibition, we went to Puerto Rico, and remember, it's during the Black Power Movement, the New Eureka Movement, so we all went with our fros out to here. And in Puerto Rico, they were like, oh, what are these young people coming to do, these New Eurekans coming to Puerto Rico to do? And we were like, we're coming for history, we're looking at our roots, right? And even my cousin was like, I'm not working out with you with your hair like that. You know, put on a scarf, put on a hat, do something. And then I understood the disconnection between what we understood as our root culture and the disconnection that we had within the United States. Because remember, Puerto Rico is a colony and continues to be one of the oldest colonies of the United States. And that we would think that a school system would honor our traditions and our history and have a narrative for who we are. All of a sudden it occurred to me, like, that's dumb. Why would a system of education want to liberate you when it worked to enslave you? So that's what started the journey of building institutions. And Museo del Barrio was that, for the Puerto Rican experience. And as I explored a broader experience, thanks to anthropologist Alegría of Puerto Rico, he said, you know what? You can't look at Puerto Rico in isolation, to Trinidad, to Haiti, to Santo Domingo, to Venezuela, to Panama, and so on and so forth, because the books don't say it, but our people traveled. Our people traveled, our people were intelligent. They had boats, they created boats. They went from island to island, from place to place. So they could start a pot in Puerto Rico and finish it in Venezuela or finish it in Haiti. So you can't look at the world through narrow eyes. You have to open your eyes. And that's what started the journey of connecting the African diaspora traditions. And that's how the Caribbean Cultural Center gets born. It gets born in the Schomburg Library, a letter that I saw that is in the collection, where Puerto Rican Artur Alfonso Schomburg writes to poet laureate Nicolás Guillén de Cuba, telling him that Langston Hughes, African American, is going to visit Cuba, and he wants to make sure that Langston Hughes sees the black community. And that letter is the creation of the Caribbean Cultural Center. Because I said, isn't that powerful that somebody here, Puerto Rican, connects to somebody in Cuba and with someone who is from the African-American experience? And so that led me to the work of Catherine Dunham, Zora Neale, right? Remember, we're in the Black Power, New Eureka Movement, to the work of Felipe, the last poets, and so on. To Amiri, and his work, to many other people who are focused on the tradition. But then I had the opportunity to meet, and Bob, if you're there, I had the good fortune of meeting Julito Collazo, who was mentioned by Robert Farris Thompson. And Julito became the curator, one of the curators for an exhibition, the first exhibition we did on African religions. called Voodoo and Santeria. And why did we do the exhibition? Because by that time I had understood that the philosophy and sacredness that we brought into the world continued. But not only continued as memory, but as a vital, energetic force of resistance and affirmation, and also a way of living that was healthy. Because when you speak to spirit, when you speak to Orisha, you speak with open arms and open heart and open head. And your head is sacred, and you know your head is sacred. And you know that all that you bring to the world is sacred. So when we did that exhibition, it was very interesting because Julito, when we went into the Metropolitan Museum of Art and into the Museum of Natural History, would see certain objects and would cross his hands and say, Marta, if you take that object, I'm not part of the show. And I was like, why? The curator said, that's a beautiful piece of work. He said, that has blood. That belongs to someone. That's from a burial ground. You can't violate the sacred. So to the curators who are putting together exhibitions, right, who think they are looking at wonderful pieces and incredible pieces of our history, and are placing them in display, what does that say? So at the end, following Julito's lead, most of the objects were created by people in the Bronx, people in Brooklyn, and people throughout New York who were working in basements, recreating Ifa boards, recreating Osheshango sticks and egg roll sticks and so on and so forth, because he refused to participate if we had violated the sacred ground of people that represented our ancestors. So that turned my whole concept of exhibitions around. It also turned around the whole concept of how I presented conferences, panels. There is no panel without traditional leaders being present. Because how would there be scholars if traditional leaders were not present? Who is the intellectual? Who is the divine intellectual? Who is the divine scholar? And that's where, when I meet Flash of the Spirit, it makes the difference for me. Because it is the first reading that I have that says you put the traditional leader at the center. Right? And that is profound. And when Julito mentioned, and I've never told this to mi hermano Thompson, right? When Julito mentioned, I want you to meet Thompson, I said, who is Thompson? Remember, I'm in my warrior mood, right? I'm Puerto Rican, black, and I'm like, I'm not taking no shit, you know? So he says, no, Thompson es blanco. He goes, oh, no, I don't want to meet Thompson. No. That's what's wrong, Charles. You know, you're always giving him information and not protecting your information. And he said, no, Thompson, as he said, Thompson, Julito Cuban. Thompson is different. He's different. He's real. And I'd like to honor Julito by having you see him. Have you played the video? Bringing in experts from different visions. People who are scholars of the sacred, people who are scholars, academicians, but not anybody. There's a process of understanding, right, what the reputation of the person, the reputation the person brings, and the relationships that they bring. And that's what Julito taught me, Catherine Dunham taught me, because I had the honor of interviewing her, that it's relationships. And you can be polka dot, you could be stripe, you could be whatever. But that you have to understand that the people who you are dealing with honor, have character, you are. And are willing to see more than you can see. Are willing to look at things from different dimensions, as Robert Burris Thompson said, that you don't look at something from one dimension, you look at it from the various dimensions and the various expertise that are available to you. And that we have a responsibility as we're building institutions and doing this work to make sure that we deconstruct. And that's what Willie was talking about. Deconstruct the racist system that through words maintains racism. What is the narrative? What are the words? And Flash of the Spirit begins to give us those words and how to talk about our experience. But we still have more to do in terms of how we talk about our work as African and African descendants. Because many of us have been trained within the walls of academia that have taught us not to acknowledge and accept and honor our divine expertise. And I give major props to Foto, right? Because in the 30-odd years that I know him, he has always honored people who are coming up as well. Not only people who have knowledge that are elders, but also has influence and giving support to young people coming up. I have to mention Alex Lasalle, who is an incredible man. Not only is he a musician, he is a dada, he is an initiate in the Lumumba tradition, his wife, Manuela. You have any number of young people who are coming up, steeped in their traditions, steeped in scholarship, and framing a dialogue of empowerment, not based on lies or false pride, but based on the fact that these traditions work and have survived because they work and because they must be honored, because in honoring them, we honor us. Thank you. Put everyone in alphabetical order so that, as Danny said, we're embracing everyone in terms of time equally. And I wanted to say one thing. I didn't show my slides, but I want to play the shadow piece when I finish this. Give me a minute. I want to say also that I met Danny in 1983 in Brazil, when we organized the International Orisha Conference in Brazil. And Danny has been a major influence in the work of the center. I'm not his boss, he's my boss. You know, we have developed some incredible exhibitions with Bonso, with Rupiao, with Henry, with so many traditional leaders and so many academicians that have helped our communities expand their information base and progress and lead careers that are multifaceted. Because I think that the power of the young people coming out now is that they are honoring all of who they are. And in doing so, are going to be some kick-ass people going forward. So you saw them this morning. And I honor their work, and we must honor that work and make sure that they are grounded in love. That's it. And this last piece is because I was going to show some macro slides for Thompson, because he has to heal. And these loving words are about healing. and it's about remembering the Palladium, and it's about remembering Mambo, and it's about saying that when you heal, this is the Mambo that you and I are going to dance.